I trust wherever you are joining us from around this big old globe, you've had a fabulous conference thus far. So you are here now for the STE Researchers Panel. My name is Dr. Nicole Gruhl. I am an advisory board member with Spiritual Awakenings International. And it is such a pleasure to be with all of you and to welcome along our next three speakers who have been doing fascinating work. So I'll introduce, we'll go one by one by one, and then we'll have some Q&A at the end. As you have your questions, please pop them in the chat throughout, and hopefully we'll get to as many as we can. So first up, I would like to introduce you to Mark Anthony. Mark Anthony is a psychic explorer, the psychic lawyer, and is a fourth generation psychic medium. Mark has had multiple types of spiritually transformative experiences. He is an Oxford educated attorney licensed to practice in Florida, Washington, and before the US Supreme Court. He is the co-host of the live stream show, The Psychic and the Doc, and the author of three books, the latest being the bestseller called The Afterlife Frequency. Mark, welcome.
Thank you so much. I want to go ahead and get started. And my presentation is The Afterlife Frequency and the Electromagnetic Soul. And this is how we are connected by the light from the cosmic to the subatomic. The truth is interdimensional communication, in other words, contact with the other side, has been documented since the dawn of recorded history. And it comes in many different forms. After-death communication, which everybody probably has experienced. In other words, visitations by a spirit where you feel that somebody's around you. One of the most popular forms is in dreams. And you know the difference between a dream and a visitation, because when a spirit connects with you in the dream state, it feels real. It felt like a real conversation. Then there is contact through a medium like myself. Other forms of spirit contact, interdimensional communication, include near-death experiences, and others include what's known as deathbed visions and shared death experiences. That's where an SDE, a shared death experience, is when somebody is in the active process of dying and people in close proximity will pick up on what that person is seeing spiritually and experiencing. The interdimensional communication is part of the human experience, and the different forms of spirit communication, interdimensional communication, can be explained through science. And what this means, and it's very important, is that faith and science are not polar opposites. Understanding interdimensional communication begins with the common denominator of light. Think about it. Our very existence depends on light. Photosynthesis, the light from the sun, is taken by plants and turned into nutrients. And then everything that we eat is either plant-based or animals that eat plants. And if it weren't for the light of the sun, Earth would be nothing more than a frozen rock drifting through space. Every great faith describes God, the divine power, in terms of light. And it extends beyond religions. It's also people that have a near-death experience or a shared death experience or deathbed visions where somebody is actively dying and they begin to describe what they're seeing. Inevitably, they talk about the light. Now, bringing this a little bit closer to our cultural home, think about Moses encountering the burning bush. He saw a bush that burned, yet it did not burn up. What was he seeing? How would you describe an encounter with an intense form of energy in the Bronze Age, which is when Moses lived? Most powerful form of energy people knew would be fire. So he'd be describing it in the terminology that he knew at the time. If you go to the New Testament, what's known as the Pentecost, this is after Jesus has left this world, he has ascended, and his mother Mary and disciples were channeling the power of the Holy Spirit, for lack of a better term, and this appeared as tongues of fire above their heads. Now, they lived in the Iron Age. How would you describe this intensive energetic connection in the vernacular of the day, which would be tongues of fire? And for those of us who do aura work, when you look at people's auras, that's the energy field around them, the crown chakra kind of flickers. And how would you describe that in the Iron Age? Like a tongue of fire. The great Islamic scholar Rumi said, "The lamps may be different, but the light is the same." Have you ever thought that you caught a glimpse of a spirit when you were looking in a mirror, and then you turned around and there wasn't anything there? What about trying to look directly at a comet? It's really hard to look directly at a comet. And then in your peripheral vision, you catch a glimpse of a spirit, you turn and look, and the spirit vanishes. Now, why do these things happen? Is this coincidence? Is this hocus pocus? Is this your imagination? Well, understanding interdimensional communication, we know it begins with light, but let's take a practical aspect of it. Let's look at the structure of the eye. The eye has many components to it, but in our vision, there are rods and cones. Rods are on the periphery of the retina, and they're extremely light sensitive. Cones at the center of the retina detect color and details. Looking at this closer, cones, that's daytime vision. That's when you look at something directly. Cones are very color sensitive and very detail oriented. That's why they're best for daytime vision. But rods, that's where you see out of your peripheral vision. Rods show light and things appear gray, black, and white. So averted vision is a technique that astronomers develop. So where you look to one side to expose the object that you're observing to the most sensitive part of your eye. So if you try to look at a comet, instead of looking at it directly, take the center of your eyes, put it off to the side, and then observe the comet through your peripheral vision. And because the light patterns being dispersed by the comet are so subtle, the rods in your eye will pick up on it. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up, this is the same in observing spirits. That's why when you turn, you see a spirit out of your peripheral vision. Well, that's exactly what's happening. It's like, I feel that my mother's around. You think you catch a glimpse of her, and you turn and look, and you feel like she vanished. She didn't vanish, or he didn't vanish. What's happening is it's the same phenomenon as observing a comet. So averted vision is a technique that we use in paranormal investigation in order to see spirits. And that's why I'm bringing this up, because for all of you that have experienced these things, the next time you think you catch a spirit out of your peripheral vision, avoid the temptation to look directly at the spirit. Instead, look at the spirit through your peripheral vision. That's also why spirits historically, in film and otherwise, have been depicted as gray and transparent, because when they are observed, it is through the rods in your peripheral vision. The only form of light visible, the only form of electromagnetic energy visible to the human eye is natural light. And this is a diagram of the electromagnetic spectrum. And that includes radio waves, microwaves, infrared, ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays. And look at what a small fraction of the EM spectrum that we're actually able to perceive. So light is electromagnetic energy. And the first law of thermodynamics and physics teaches that energy is neither created nor destroyed, only transferred from one form to another. As Albert Einstein observed, matter is energy, energy is light, we are all light beings. Well, we all had to learn in junior high school science that everything is composed of molecules. Molecules, in turn, are composed of atoms, which are made up of electrons, protons, and neutrons. And they, in turn, are composed of a smaller particle of electromagnetic energy known as a quantum. And this is where the term quantum physics comes from. This is extremely important because on this subatomic level, everything is electromagnetic energy. Traditionally, science has been split into physics, the study of energy and inorganic matter, versus biology, the study of living matter. But on the subatomic level, there is no distinction between biology or physics because everything is electromagnetic energy. Let's think about that for a minute. That means you, me, the chairs that we're sitting on are all at the subatomic level, the same form of electromagnetic energy. That also means the radio waves that this program, this summit, is being broadcast on. That means the surface of the moon, Mars, the distance between the stars are all on the subatomic level quantum electromagnetic energy. So with quantum physics, we now know in the 20th and now the 21st century that matter and energy, which includes light, are composed of quantum particles of electromagnetic energy. So we also know, as Professor Tam Hunt and Jonathan Schooler of University of California, Santa Barbara pointed out, everything has a vibration. All things in our universe are constantly in motion and vibrating. Even objects that appear to be stationary are in fact vibrating, oscillating, resonating at various frequencies. In other words, everything vibrates on the subatomic level. Neuroscience is the study of the human brain. Now, the brain is essentially a carbon-12 and salt resonator floating in water. It has an electromagnetic field. And the official position of neuroscience is that the brain creates consciousness, but neuroscientists can't figure out how this happens. So you can get a neuroscience book, it'd be 900 pages. Guess what? There may be a paragraph about consciousness. The rest of it is going to be about functions of the brain, but not how the brain creates consciousness. Physicists have now joined the debate, and Professor Hans-Peter Dohr from the Max Planck Institute in Germany stated that the brain is like a computer hard drive. And when the hard drive dies, the information, this consciousness, doesn't die, but transfers to the quantum field. And then Sir Roger Penrose from my old alma mater, Oxford University, along with Stuart Hammerhoff and Roderick Ekanoff and Professor Bandiopathy, stated that consciousness derives from quantum vibrations within the brain's neurons. In the spiritual sense, consciousness has been here all along. So what they're saying is that consciousness, who and what we are, pre-exists the body. And this is why I began years of study to develop the term the electromagnetic soul, which is a 21st century term to describe who and what we really are, which is a soul that is pure consciousness, which is eternal electromagnetic energy. I developed this over years of study and observation, both scientifically and through my work as a psychic medium, where I facilitate communication between people here in this world and the other side. Physics, energy is neither created nor destroyed, only transferred from one form to another. And faith, every great belief system teaches that the soul, the spirit, who and what we are, pre-exists the body, comes into the body, and moves on after the body dies. So I introduced the term the electromagnetic soul, EMS for short, and I'm very honored and humbled that a number of scientists have started using the term since the release of my book, The Afterlife Frequency. We know that the brain has different frequencies. Brainwave frequencies are the electrical activity going on in the brain, which can be measured. Brainwave frequency of someone sleeping, for example, is very different from someone who's awake. And as technology advances, this has yielded a greater understanding of exactly what brainwaves represent and indicate about a person's health and state of mind. We have five different brainwave frequencies. Let's start at the top, gamma, wow, that's when we're in overdrive. Think of Matt Imodio or Ken Jennings on Jeopardy, all right? That's when you are cranking your brain at full throttle. Beta is the state that we're pretty much all in right now. That's the, I got out of bed, I can tie my shoes, I can use a computer and drive a car and function. That's our normal everyday awake state. But then as we relax and start to drift off to daydream or meditation, we start to fall asleep, that's the alpha state. I always call it the groovy baby state because that's, you know, where you're relaxed and feeling really good. And then you go from alpha, you drift into theta. Theta is a dreamful sleep. Then there's delta. For a long time, neuroscientists were kind of disregarding delta. But now we know that delta is when your body heals itself. This is cellular regeneration. So it has a very important part. The reason that I created this diagram and put the pink arrow in there, it is on the alpha theta border when psychic activity occurs. So when we drift from beta to the alpha theta state, this brainwave activity is conducive to spirit communication. And they spot that. And that's why the dream state is such a popular means of spirits communicating with us. People like me, mediums, for some reason that we still do not yet understand, we're able to switch from beta to alpha theta within seconds to engage in spirit communication. Normally, it takes hours to do that. So that's something that's also being studied. So what the skeptics say is, well, why don't we just use a device like an EEG, an electroencephalogram, to measure the electromagnetic soul? Well, EEGs and QEEGs, quantitative electroencephalograms, are extremely useful in medical research and diagnosis, but they're not sensitive enough nor designed to identify the electromagnetic soul, much less tune into the afterlife frequency. And as Shelley Renee Joy of the California Institute of Integral Studies has stated, it is entirely feasible that there are specific ranges of harmonic frequencies that interact with mind-brain systems through resonance at far higher frequencies than currently supposed. In other words, what's going on with the EMS and the afterlife frequency is way beyond our current technology, and I say current technology, to detect it. Or is it? This year, February 2nd of 2022, a report came out from Tartu, Estonia. An 87-year-old man was being monitored by an EEG. He had had a stroke and he was in the hospital, and then he died during the EEG test. Now, this had never happened before where somebody was actually being brain studied by an EEG when they died. The scientists were astounded by what they found. Just before and after the heart stopped working, we saw changes in a band of neural oscillations, so-called gamma. Remember I was talking about gamma waves being the super high frequency, but also in others, delta, theta, alpha, and beta. In other words, right before death, the brain went into full gear. Then other scientists analyzed this and said that the brain may be playing a last recall of important life events before we die, similar to ones reported in a near-death experience. So it is possible that for the first time in history, a life review was actually detected by an EEG scan. Now, similar studies have been conducted in mice, but never on a human being before. And this is a very exciting development that right before death, when you would think that the brain would be flatlining and ready to shut off, instead there was a massive surge of activity.
1 minute left, Mark.
Oh boy, I got a lot more than that to go.
Sorry.
So down to this. What happens is with the afterlife frequency and the material world dimension, all the different forms of spirit communication occur when there's an overlap between the electromagnetic soul and the afterlife frequency. That includes mediumship, visitations, near-death experiences, shared death experiences, deathbed visions, and out-of-body experiences. And if people want to find out more about my work in my study, which has been endorsed by the top near-death experience and survival of consciousness scientists in the world. My latest book, The Afterlife Frequency, goes into this in extreme detail. Please visit my website, afterlifefrequency.com. Sign up for my newsletter. I've got two spirit communication events coming up June 24th and 25th, online events where I'll be connecting attendees with their loved ones in spirit. And you can also sign up for a one-on-one reading with me as well. And you can go to my website, afterlifefrequency.com.
Amazing, Mark. Thank you so much. Just incredible. Make sure the link is popped into the chat there for those that want to follow up with that. We could take a whole day on just you, Mark. So thank you.
I tried to make this presentation as short as possible because I wanted to get into other the practical application of what I introduce in the afterlife frequency. But that's fine because, you know, I'll just have to come back and do another presentation here.
Exactly right. We look forward to that. So I'd now like to introduce Marie Grace Brook. Dr. Marie Grace Brook has had multiple spiritually transformative experiences. She has a PhD from the Institute of Transpersonal Psychology. She has served on the boards of the American ASSIST, so the American Center for the Integration of Spiritually Transformative Experiences, as well as Spiritual Emergence Anonymous, C. Marie Grace felt called to research how people integrate their powerful STEs. I personally know Marie Grace's story. It's a potent one, and I look forward to hearing what she has to share today. She has a private practice, teaches spiritual direction, and runs a small retreat in Santa Cruz. Marie Grace, welcome to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Really nice to be here, and thank you, Yvonne and Spiritual Awakenings International. This is great to be here, and in the 20 minutes I'm given, I'm going to try to split my time between maybe the first half talking about some of my experiences and then the second half talking about the research. So we'll start with my experiences. That seems like a good place to start. And I was 25 years old when I had my first spiritually transformative experience. I had found a book about meditation. This is in 1980. And it said, I remember vividly, I read, well, if you want to be enlightened, you're going to have to meditate a lot of years, possibly a lot of lifetimes. And I thought to myself, with my 25-year-old brain, who had never heard of any of this before, except a little bit, you know, I better start now. So I started immediately, and I read in the book how to meditate, and I did it devotedly for 1 hour every morning. And after about 6 months, things started really opening up. I had mystical experiences, rapid sequence of revelations, telepathy, clairvoyance, energetic openings, shifting paradigms of reality. And I could, within a few weeks, I realized that if things kept happening so fast, I was going to be vulnerable to be putting in a mental health institute. And then I decided I did not want that. I knew it was a spiritual experience, although I knew nothing about spirituality. I was not brought up in a spiritual household. I was brought up by scientists who believed in totally in the medical profession. And I thought, okay, well, what I will do is I will take 1 year. I'll take 12 months, and then I will figure out what's going on. So I found a cabin in the woods, high in the mountains, and went and sat in the cabin for 12 months, figuring that that should be enough time. And I had access. I could go down to town to the library, and I knew I needed to read about spiritual things. There were some lovely things about that year. Certainly the states that I reached, and especially I remember treasuring reading these spiritual books, mostly historical. There wasn't much going on currently at that time, a little bit. Mostly read Buddhist and yoga and Taoist stuff that was kind of brought over to America that was popular in the 70s. But also I didn't sleep. And when I did fall asleep, I'd wake up with screaming nightmares. So over the year, although I learned a lot and a lot happened, I was not ready a year later to go back to town. But I had run out of money. So I had to go back to town and I had to start working and I had to just deal with it, basically. It was a rough 3 years. I still remember driving through intersections and wondering, was that light red or not? And glancing in my mirror and seeing that I'd gone right through a red light. It was very, very difficult 3 years to live through. And after about the fourth year, I think I can truly say, and I felt this in my heart, that no one was going to lock me up and I could fake being normal. But that was not the only one. So I kind of normalized. Realized I wanted to be a mother, got married. Then in 1992, I had another incredible spiritual experience that shook the whole foundation of my life, which was an awakening to the heart of Christ in a very physical, energetic way of feeling the heart and the light and the love of what created this whole universe. This changed a lot of things, ended up changing my marriage. And in 1996, there was another one that came from a healing arts institute that I went to, Unleashing Divine Feminine Energy is what I call it. By the way, I just made up these names this week when I was writing up this presentation. I said, how would I describe these things? So I came up with a name for each one of them. And each time I realized I was called to something new, I moved. I had a completely different life and had new professions. In 2009, it was what I call a Kundalini realignment. It was a sacral illness on my sacrum that I now call my sacred illness. And I ended up going back to the woods and sitting on mountaintops for a year, just sitting. And then in 2012, went to another event with a teacher, reached Bindu, which is a Hindu term, and also experienced Bodhisattva, which is a Buddhist term. And let's see, by then I was almost in my third marriage and found myself doing yet more new, unexpected things I never thought I'd be doing. This is probably a better description of what I've been going through, easier to imagine. 1981 to 2022 is the period of time I'm talking about. And I just want to say that I loved what Robert Baer said when he said, well, why did I come back? Why did I come back? I guess it was just to tell other people about this and to help them. And it's like, you just got to do what you got to do. Well, this is kind of what my life was like. And I'm in a really nice place now. But I had to hold on for a lot of decades and decide that it was worth it every day to wake up and actually face life because it was rough. Although there were beautiful, beautiful times, it was rough. So I went through failed relationships, divorces, highly sensitive to crowds, EMFs, sounds, bright lights. And lately, I am becoming a calm, resilient, and even a less high-maintenance wife. I was a very overwhelmed mother. Just motherhood was not easy for me, but because I was centered in love and I knew without a doubt at every moment of my life that it was all about love, that just got me through. And my kids are now adults and they're doing really well and I'm becoming a very graceful grandmother. As far as career-wise, same kind of nightmare, multiple part-time jobs, getting fired a lot, moving on a lot. And now in the last years, I've been able to have a serene spiritual direction practice, and I'm finishing my book on STEs. And as for the jobs, tough work, menial labor, no future in sight, always in these jobs that I was just like, well, what am I doing here? What am I doing here? Never could work full time. And now I'm, besides being a spiritual director, I'm becoming a principal investigator for STE research, which is very fulfilling. So it's nice to help give hope to people who are in these spiritual emergencies. And it's been particularly nice to bring this study to the level of research and be published in professional journals. Integration of spiritually transformative experience inventory was how I did this. It's an inventory I created so that I could research how people do integrate spiritual emergencies. I created this inventory while I was getting my PhD as my dissertation, compiled 84 practices, habits, and behaviors that assist in integrating STEs using research from experts in the field. Yvonne Kaysen, whom you all know, mentions in her book, Farther Shores, 35, she lists 35 survival techniques for STE integration. So I started with those. I added 9 therapeutic interventions for STE integration that appears in a seminal article by David Lukoff, who spoke earlier today. Ryan Rominger, who did his PhD also researching STEs, formulated 4 and described 4 situations that ease STE integration. And Yolaine Stout did some wonderful research. She's a leader and investigator and a founder of ASSIST, the American Center for the Integration of Spiritually Transformative Experiences. And through her research, isolated 6 challenges in the integration of STEs. So I took these and expanded them, got into detail, what are these people saying, got rid of duplicates, came up with 84 clear practices, habits, and behaviors. I assigned them to 8 groups and then created this inventory for a survey. Generally, they covered social situations needed to integrate spiritual emergencies, supportive environments, supportive activities, spiritual practices, self-exploration, seeking professional clinical help, adjusting to heightened sensitivities, and healthier nutrition habits. Put it on SurveyMonkey and advertised it as, have you experienced a spiritual event that transformed your life that took months to years to integrate? And I know some of you here have replied to that survey and were some of the participants, and probably most of you, many of you may have, and I don't know, of course, because it was all anonymous, but some of my friends told me, of course, that they would do it. The sample from the survey was 413 people worldwide that answered the survey, and then I put them through 2 psychological tests to make sure they met the criteria. Had they really experienced a transformative spiritual experience, meaning did it really transform their lives? The second is, had they really integrated it? And I gave them a standard mental health test to make sure that they were stable. So of those that started the survey, 413, 234 met criteria. These are the nationalities. You can see all over the world. Most people, I'm sure, were English speaking, but I could tell many of them had English as their second language. The STEs I'm reading here are actually ones that come from the text boxes at the end of the survey where I ask people about their experiences. So I'm just going to list some of them for you here. Intense mystical experiences, near-death experiences, extreme trauma or illness, Kundalini awakenings, shared crossings, meditation or yoga-related, childbirth, conversion experiences, shamanic initiations, paranormal experiences. And I divided the definition of integration into 2 parts and asked people to report on those. One I called social adjustment, and the second was psycho-spiritual integration, because I suspected that they're really 2 different things. The social adjustment is, can you hold down a job? Can you support your life? And have you gathered a social support system around you so that you can function in society, and from the outside, you can be considered normal, because that's the way I did it first. And then the second one is psycho-spiritual integration, which is you become one with yourself, you're comfortable with your identity, your lifestyle, and your purpose and your work reflects who you really are all the way through. Sure enough, you'll see in blue, the social adjustment came first. Often in days, it shows, all the way days through weeks, months, and years, whereas psycho-spiritual integration, the greatest number reported years to integrate psycho-spiritually. There were four really important findings from this research, and all of them were of high statistical significance, which means that across the board, they were the same, which is very significant because this is the first research that I know of that was done doing an umbrella of all these various types of STEs. Although they've been written about in a group by a few people, Yvonne Kaysen being perhaps the first, research had usually been done strictly with something like NDEs or conversion experiences or psi experiences. This was started with an assumption that there were commonalities with all of them, and it indeed proved it because all these various types of STEs showed to have basic commonalities in methods of integration. Perhaps the experiences weren't the same, but the ways that people said they integrated them were alike. Correspondence of use to helpfulness. This is significant because the research was done in 2015 and 16, or I'm sorry, the survey was put out then. This was before the burgeoning of information online. So you couldn't go out and find these things. You couldn't find the definitions. You couldn't find the groups. You couldn't find the education online. So, and these people, of course, had experienced these their actual STEs up to years and decades before. So basically, which was confirmed by the narrative, people went through these things alone back then. And I compared that to what they rated as most helpful. Well, it turned out that they were the same, that the practices that people found most helpful across the board were exactly the ones that pretty much everybody tried. I mean, a lot of them, some people tried, and a lot of them, some people felt they were helpful. But it was pretty amazing, which shows that people undergoing spiritual emergencies can be trusted to know best what they need. This is significant because, of course, my purpose in doing this is to bring it to the medical profession. I don't have to preach to you. You're the choir. I want to bring this to the medical profession and to the educators and to the mental health professionals. So this needs to be emphasized that when someone comes in spiritual emergency, they can be trusted to know what is best for them. A third thing came very unexpected. I was not even looking for this, but there was a radical difference between almost all the practices or any of the practices that had to do with psychiatric help. And it was that pretty much everyone across the board, except a very few exceptions, said that psychiatric help was either detrimental or not helpful, unhelpful. And many expressed how much they regretted it. And there were many stories of people who had been in and out of mental institutions. So here are the essential practices that 100% people said were essential. I had it rated as essential, very helpful, somewhat helpful, not helpful. So 100% of people, of all of these 234 people that met criteria, said that these were essential. The first one I will give credit to Yvonne Kaysen, because I picked these first five up from her book, Farther Shores, which is practicing compassion, forgiveness, humility, honesty, and gratitude. And I want to emphasize something, which is I even took these apart. Each one was a separate item on the inventory survey. Still, all five of those came out right at the top. The second, and remember, all six of these were essential for everybody that took the survey, that were participants.
Second, Marie Grace, 1 minute left.
Okay, calmer environment, time in nature, adjust to new sensitivities, find at least one person to confide in, allow the unconscious to surface, creatively live a revised purpose in life. And there was one more that came at the very bottom where I had a text box asking people, was there anything you would like to add to this list of 84 practices? And overwhelmingly, this was the answer: time. My gratitude to Spiritual Awakenings International for bringing STEs into the public eye. and my gratitude to Spiritual Emergence Anonymous for continued group support and inspiration. My gratitude to you, my fellow companions along the journey, for showing up, for bringing your presence and abundance of divine blessings. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Marie Grace, for sharing the journey and the findings, lots of clapping, and there was lots of nodding going on throughout that. Fabulous. Thank you. We'll be coming back to you in our questions. So we'll move on now to our third panelist, who is Monique Rebelle. So Monique was born in Poland and now lives in the USA. In 1992, she had a powerful, spontaneous Kundalini awakening that led her to research Kundalini. She is an artist, painter, and spiritual leader. She is also the author of the best-selling book, Transcendence Calling, The Power of Kundalini Rising and Spiritual Enlightenment. Monique, welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm very, very grateful to participate in this fascinating event. It is not possible to describe my whole experience in 20 minutes, but I will tell you how it started. I have to do something here. Gosh, I don't know how. Oh, there it is. Sorry. I will tell you how it started, and then I will present some of my main insights. Let's backtrack to the day when, after years of struggle, months of depression, and on the verge of suicide, my life changed forever. I was about to leave my art studio, I'm a painter, to go to the store and get razor blades. I could not stand my life anymore, and I was ready to end it. On the way out, I glanced at the bathroom door and suddenly decided to take a shower in hope to soothe my emotions. I only collapsed in the tub and desperately tried to deal with the violent urge that made me want to kill myself. For years, I was dealing with my emotional pain by making myself focus on my art. It was a subconscious process, which now I needed to use consciously, as the emotions were overpowering, uncontrollable. With all of my mental effort, I decided to look into the horrifying emotion. It was very uncomfortable, but as soon as I called it depression, I felt I had a grip on it. It was not anymore unknown and limitless. I saw it covering me up like a dark cloud. My next decision was to step out of it. When I moved away from the dark cloud of depression, I found myself in a vacuum-like, hollow space. I called it emptiness. The awful emotion still kept on coming back and in waves. And during the next few minutes, I repeated the process of stepping out of it. Eventually, I managed to remain in the state of emptiness and felt no emotion. I noticed then that all I had was my breath, and I focused on breathing. My mind, however, kept on thinking and invariably arriving at the same conclusion. The only correct thing to do was to end my life. Eventually, not finding any other way out, I surrendered to that thought. After a while, with my eyes closed, I opened my eyes. In front of me, on the white background of the tub, was a rope of rainbow light dancing peacefully. There were no rainbows anywhere close to my imagination. My life was done, and there was nothing colorful about it. The longer I watched the rainbow rope, the more scared I became. It was not of the world I knew. It was real, but also truly supernatural. Terrified, I was rushing out of the tub when I noticed that the rainbow was moving with me. It was a part of me, and I could not get away from it. I was about to panic, But then I conquered my fear and sat down waiting for something to happen, or whatever would happen. In the next 20 minutes, the magical process took place on its own, and I was able to experience my consciousness traveling through several different worlds that I soon called dimensions of perception. I relived all of my life by following my thoughts from my earliest childhood, observed them continue through the years until they all, one by one, got resolved by reaching the present time, and then instantly vanished. I watched and felt my ego fall off me like a thick shell of a dried up mud. Suddenly, I received care and support and found eternal love. I listened to heavenly orchestra and was greeted by ascended masters, not knowing who they were. I found my essence in the matrix of creation. I saw through the illusion of our common reality and illusion of time. My soul self-realized as an eternal being. At the end, unable to find any more thoughts, in an explosion of light, my consciousness united with all that is. Everything became completely clear, and my life changed forever. Without words, I comprehended thoroughly every step of the process and the final result. Within a short time after the experience, I realized that all my emotional pain was gone, and I felt peace and happiness for no apparent reason. Although I was aware that the experience was not describable in its entirety, I had a feeling that someday I would be able to present some of it with as much clarity as possible so others can use my insights to their benefit. I went through my experience without any prior knowledge about Kundalini, subtle body, or chakras. In time, I was able to compare my experience with what is already known about the process of Kundalini rising. Today, we know much more about this incredible phenomenon, and we also know that the number of people who experience various stages of Kundalini rising is growing. Many Kundalini rising experiences are often partial rising. And as much as they can be powerful and life-changing, they can also be, they can also be troublesome. Another spiritual phenomenon that is often mistakenly seen as Kundalini rising is spontaneous openings of one of the upper chakras. In order to make this and other points of my presentation more clear, I need to briefly explain the basic principles which I was able to observe during and after my experience, and also later in sessions with my students and talks with others. First of all, Kundalini, meaning called up in Sanskrit, is usually considered to be a dormant energy that awakens and uncoils under some circumstances. In my understanding, this energy is simply our consciousness. All that you are, all that you know, is your Kundalini. Therefore, I call it our individual unit of consciousness. What we see here is a very simple image of the subtle body consisting of Kundalini energy and chakras. Kundalini normally rests at the bottom of the spine, chakras, wheels, or circles in Sanskrit, are known as energy vortexes or centers. According to the ancient knowledge, each of them relates to a different part of our bodies and affects different aspects of our lives. It is known from the mystical traditions of old India that Kundalini can travel all the way up through the chakras and exits out of the crown chakra. That's when individual soul meets with all that is, the ultimate consciousness. This process can take anywhere from a few minutes to days, months, years, or lifetimes. In my understanding, in most of us humans, the first three chakras are open, although the second and the third one are usually congested. The upper chakras are often not active, closed up or underdeveloped, but some of us have some of the upper ones open and more developed. Kundalini is consciousness, but it also needs to be understood as spirit. Our spirit creates the subtle body and coils up between the first and second chakra. Also, according to my understanding, from being formless and without any attributes, spirit, once in the body, becomes survival, sexual, and creative. Although chakras can be seen as energy centers, I assign to them another important function. Because during my experience, I could observe my consciousness transiting through different worlds, I understand chakras as the personal gates to the ever-present universal dimensions of perception. Each of these dimensions operates on a different principle, and when it comes to using this knowledge for the purpose of healing, personal growth, and betterment of mankind, we first need to address each dimension separately. During our lifetimes, we experience a fusion of the energy of the dimensions available through the chakras. Here is a brief summary of each dimension. The first chakra is the gate to the first dimension, the material one. It is all of the material world, including our bodies. The material dimension is enormous and intricate. In our customary understanding, there are three dimensions, length, width, and depth. But I see those as just sub-dimensions of the material one. The second dimension is emotional. It ranges from the most unhappy to the happiest. Emotions monitor us constantly and affect our decisions all the time. Unresolved emotions get stored in the second chakra. The third dimension is mental. It is the mind. A very important dimension because we tend to understand life through its perspective and try to live by its measures. It is our logical, linear thinking propelled by the power of our will. It is a goal-oriented speculation. The mental structures that create our personalities are stored in this chakra and condition our decision-making. The mankind has been dominated by the material, emotional, and mental chakras. The dominance of the first three chakras is what is known as ego. The mind tries to assume total control, but it cannot reach the upper dimensions because its method of operation is limited to linear thinking. Still, as our Kundalini travels up, the self-inquiry process begins with the power of the third chakra and continues all the way through the upper dimensions. In my understanding, the sub-dimension of the third dimension is time. Other dimensions exist without the measure of time. The fourth dimension is the sphere of eternal, universal love. Something that spiritual teachers like Jesus Christ, Buddha, and many others have been talking about a lot. Some of us have this chakra open and understand the importance of loving and caring about all of life, while most of us can feel the power of love in personal relationships. If our Kundalini is able to break through the lower chakras and enter the fourth one, or if our fourth chakra is fully open anyway, our life experience becomes sacred. The fifth dimension is about exchange of energy. Here we have the magical powers of sound, musical harmonies, dance, performance, psychic powers, telepathy, connections with spirits, angels, beings from other galaxies, and more. Reading of the Akashic records, near-death experiences, and out-of-body experiences happen in the vibration of the fifth dimension. The sixth dimension is our vision and intuition, the third eye. This image of the subtle body comes from the visionary projection of that dimension. In the fifth dimension, we receive the help and communication we are looking for. In the sixth one, we engage in our own investigation into the depth of our consciousness. We intuitively read mystical visions, comprehend sacred symbols, concepts, and whole systems of esoteric sciences like astrology, numerology, sacred geometry, tarot cards, and more. In this dimension, we meet with archetypes. We can explore the power of religions together with pantheons of gods. Visual understanding of abstract concepts. It's one of the upper layers of this rich dimension. Eventually, we can see through the illusion of our mundane reality, ego, and time. In one of the last layers of the transit through the sixth dimension, our consciousness, which started the journey as an uncoiling Kundalini, self-realizes as an immortal soul. The seventh dimension is our higher mind. The third chakra mind is goal-oriented and concludes by identification. The seventh chakra mind observes, witnesses, and contemplates. It concludes by discernment. In the seventh dimension, we find the deepest universal spiritual truths that uniformly apply to everything and everyone. If our self-realized soul continues the process of self-inquiry, the right answers will appear and the seventh chakra will burst open. Here, our consciousness unites with all that is in ever-present explosion of light, in absolute awareness and bliss. One becomes a conscious creator engaged in the continuous inspired act of creating by simply being one with all that is. The mission of Kundalini rising, in my view, is not a temporary state of nirvana when our awakened consciousness is able to exit through the seventh chakra and unite with all that is. The needed result is to make the experience stable and elevate the seat of our consciousness from the sacrum area to the heart area. From the seat in the heart, you can reach lower and upper dimensions at any time and live in sacred communion with human and God alike. On the practical level, the process of training the lower chakras and cultivating the upper ones is what needs to be done, so our Kundalini can accomplish its mission and transform into an immortal soul that eventually merges with all that is and is still a continuous human existence,
creating 1 minute left, Monique.
Beautiful life for all of life. Regardless how advanced on the spiritual path we are, we always need to practice because all of the chakras need to be active and sufficiently cleared from all the stagnant energy. Each chakra requires a different set of practices. More details about my personal experience, transformation, and insights can be found in my book, Transcendence Calling, The Power of Kundalini Rising and Spiritual Enlightenment. The program that I teach is titled Higher Self, A Course in Multidimensional Consciousness System. And further information is on my website, moniquerebelle.com. Thank you so much for your attention.
Monique, thank you so much for sharing such a deep and powerful personal story, for hanging around on planet Earth to share the teachings and the findings. Marvelous. So everybody who's been with us, thank you for busily typing in your questions. We have about 15 minutes now to get some of those questions. We won't get all of the questions answered, but we're going to do our best. So I'm going to welcome back all three of our panelists, and we will jump around a bit with our questions now. So we'll start, Mark, with a couple of questions for you, and perhaps you can try and make the answers quick and punchy, and then we can get through many questions. So the first one, Mark, and it's a biggie though, is God actually electromagnetic energy?
That is one of the things that I discuss in depth in my book, The Afterlife Frequency, and that's what I was getting at with the story about Moses and with the Pentecost, is that in near-death experiences and in any type of spiritual experience, people talk about the light. And that's why I draw the parallel between electromagnetic energy, the light, and the divine power. And in my book, I go into my near-death experience, which goes into the light very heavily. What Nikola Tesla said was that what one person calls God, another calls the laws of physics. So is God electromagnetic energy? Very, very possibly. Or the electromagnetic energy is an aspect of what God is.
Does EMS also relate or correspond to auras?
Absolutely. Everything has an aura. A light bulb has an aura. I mean, look behind me at the Tesla sphere. You can tell I like Tesla, I like Einstein, and the lamp there. Anything with an energy field has an aura. And the EMS is part of our body's electrical field. The most complex electrical system in the body is within the brain. The most powerful is the heart, which makes sense because it's a pump. I mean, it's got to be going 24/7, but our entire body has an electrical field. And I get into very deep discussions about biophotons, and Yvonne had me on deck in case I had to do a full presentation, and my full presentation would have included biophotons, which are how our cells produce light on a cellular level and how our body actually communicates using a matrix of light. But to answer your question directly, yes, auras are tied into our body's EM field and the electromagnetic soul. We got a couple chakras going on here. You got the third eye chakra and the crown chakra. So the answer is yes.
We're going to jump over with some questions for Marie Grace. Marie Grace, can you elaborate on the idea of work play in terms of being able to relate to the awakening of spiritual dance?
I'm sorry, work play related to spiritual what?
Yeah, spiritual dance, the awakening of spiritual dance.
Spiritual death?
It says spiritual dance in the question. Maybe we'll get Bill to elaborate. So I'll move on with another question then. Were certain psych medicines or therapeutic modalities identified as helpful or unhelpful?
I would say psych medicines from prescription. I have had people approach me who said that occasionally the medications that calm someone down, like anti-anxiety, can be helpful because the anxiety is so high, depending upon how challenging the spiritual emergency is. And the ones that kind of across the board people wish they really had never had to go through are the antipsychotics. Is that a good answer?
Yeah, well, I'm agreeing with you. Yes. So fabulous. Thank you. And here's a lovely one too, Marie. Can you discuss the future directions for STEs, that spiritually transformative experience research, given you're deep in that area?
That's an interesting question, because the day after tomorrow, I am supposed to find out if a grant from the Templeton Foundation that has been Templeton Foundation has sent out a calling for research for several million dollars for different research projects to bring about spiritual competencies into the mental health professions. Which David Lukoff is working on that too. I believe he mentioned that. And I PI'd a proposal over the last several months to see if we could get a section of that specifically for bringing that into mental health clinicians' education in graduate schools. There has been some already into psychiatry, although it's kind of here and there and in between, and psychiatrists have to be interested enough to kind of reach out and get it. This grant, if it goes through, will hopefully like apply to all the schools, and it may take several years, of course, to get it established, but it would be comprehensive enough that that people would be educated. Now, whether or not they will accept a research proposal specifically to educate for STEs, I'll find out on Monday. Is that helpful?
Fantastic. Thank you, Marie Grace. And to jump back to the other question, so it's been elaborated on, and I'll just kind of pack it together and hopefully I do it justice, Bill. I think the question is about, can you elaborate on the idea of work and play in relation as one is opening to the spiritual dance, is called here, or the spiritual journey, I guess might be another way of saying that. Perhaps that came up, Marie, because you had spoken about your own challenges in your story of navigating between the workspace and the journey.
Okay, so work and play. You know, I think the only difference between work and play is just your attitude. And so if your attitude is light, it's play. And if it's not light, it's work. So, you know, when I think back, stuff that I do on my own, I'm not getting paid for it, but it's difficult and I'm struggling, it is work. And that's why people call it like spiritual work, right? But if I'm light about it, it's spiritual play. The flip side with the work I do. I mean, now when I do spiritual direction, basically my job is to sit and just listen and witness people's experience and help them tie that into where guidance is leading them. Just a little bit, mostly just companioning them. It's kind of like I get to just walk alongside them and it feels like play, but it is my work. So I don't know that that's any different in the spiritual emergence that people go through as we grow or anything else in life.
It's just. Thank you, Marie Grace. Go ahead.
That was it. Thank you.
Okay, lovely. Monique, a question for you here. Beyond meditation, what are the things we can do to bring about the Kundalini awakening?
The way I see it is that very often there is an idea that we need to awaken Kundalini, and there have been tries to do that, and very often it's not working right. And the reason for it is that especially that second chakra and the third chakra are congested. The second one is congested with emotional charge, and the third one is congested with mental charge, with all the thoughts that we've collected over our lifetime or maybe even past lives. So the method that I teach is to work on each chakra separately to basically the first one is to have it have our body healthy, to live a healthy lifestyle, good nutrition, nice environment, and so on. The second one, there are special exercises for the second chakra to clear the charge, the emotional charge that we feel so often, and we don't really do that much about it. And on every chakra, there is a different practice. The meditation helps with the third chakra because it helps to quiet the thoughts. So thoughts slow down, and very often it works on the seventh chakra as well. But I've noticed that people come to me with a problem of having the seventh chakra really buzzing, but the rest of them are not really trained and not cultivated. So just awakening Kundalini, which is possible to do, there are tantric practices, and also knowing from Buddha's time, ascetic practices, when we neglect in some ways our physical body, fasting, and so on, that causes Kundalini to awaken because it's spirit, because it's survival, sexual. So it awakens when we feel danger. So many experiences, near-death experiences can often also make Kundalini awake, and very often they do that. But the way it needs to be done, so we are ready, so our system, our subtle body system is ready for Kundalini rising, then we can do it. So I basically just teach the first part of getting everything ready, and then Kundalini will come up when it wants to.
Beautiful. Thank you, Monique. I love that, when it wants to. Prepare the grounds for readiness. We'll wrap up with one final quick one for Mark. Mark, what is connection? What is the connection between the electromagnetic soul and the collective consciousness?
Oh my God. I could spend like
you have 2 minutes
talking about this. Okay. Think of your soul, your EMS, as a drop of water. And when we die, that drop of water leaves our physical body and plunges into the eternal sea of the collective consciousness. You maintain your individuality, but now you are energetically linked to other spirits, and you become part of the collective consciousness. Now, this is not some airy-fairy granola thing that I came up with, but rather a serious study that I've conducted over years, and it coincides with over 50 years now of near-death experience and survival of consciousness studies. Interestingly enough, during my research, I also found that Edgar Cayce referred to this same phenomenon as the universal mind. And so that's why when I'm doing readings on people, I tend to get a lot of medical information about the person I'm doing the reading for. Now, I was a prosecutor, criminal defense, and personal injury attorney, so I do have a basic understanding of anatomy and physiology. But a spirit will come through and start talking to me about the genetic disorders, chromosomal anomalies, and all of these really in-depth things that I personally do not know anything about. And I've had hundreds of incidents where people have gone to their physicians and it's all been verified. So why am I bringing this up? That's because the collective consciousness, when a spirit is communicating with you, we tend to think of spirit communication as individualized, one spirit talking to one person. But that spirit is the lead singer for the chorus. that is the collective consciousness. So they're harmonized with this vast database. And that is why an EMS, an electromagnetic soul, can transmit information that far exceeded the scope of anything he or she knew in this world. That is the shortest explanation I could give you about that. But I do a lot of work with collective consciousness communication, how incredibly powerful it is. And I've been receiving messages about it about 6 months before the pandemic. For example, I was doing readings for all these different people. And during the readings, their loved ones would show up wearing masks. And they kept saying, March 2022, March 2022. And I'd ask the people, well, were they in the medical field? Were they? They said, no, nobody was a nurse or a doctor, and I'm not. And then in March 2022, I started getting emails right and left from my clients saying, oh my God, we figured it out. That's what they were talking about, the masks, because that's when the pandemic hit. And once again, the collective consciousness being on that quantum level, on the electromagnetic quantum level, time as we know it does not exist, which is why spirits can see past, present, and what we call future events. So I hope that answers your question.
Mark, thank you. Everybody, thank you so much for this collection of consciousness as we have come together in this time. I'd love to once again thank each of our panelists, Mark Anthony, Dr. Marie Grace Brook, Monique Rebelle, for sharing so in depth and so beautifully, and for your shared wisdom as well.